Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone. You tune in to another edition of Soul Facts, a show highlighting the history and music of legendary artists and preserving their legacy. And this edition features a group that excelled at outstanding merit as vocalists and musicians that cemented their legacy in R&B and pop history during the Motown sound. Soul Facts spotlight artists Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers. West Grand Boulevard, Detroit, Michigan. Within that street lies a famous record company, Hitsville, USA, that reads above its large window panes. It's known to the world as Motown Records. In the mid-1960s, the sounds of Motown were breaking social barriers and taking the world by storm by a roster of great talent, songwriters, producers, arrangers, and musicians, such as the Funk Brothers. One such group to join the Motown roster was discovered in Vancouver, Canada in 1966. Let's start from the beginning, shall we? Robert Edward Taylor, as known as Bobby Taylor, was born on Sunday, February 18, 1934 in Washington, D.C. Taylor's daughter claimed that her father was actually born in 1939, as the Washington Census records indicate. Also printed sources documented that Bobby was from North Carolina, then moved to Washington, D.C. later on. Well, I'll stick to his upbringing birthplace of D.C. His mother, Ethel Mae Kemp, was a beautician, and his father, Raymond Taylor, left home when Bobby was very young. As a teenager, Bobby moved in with relatives in Columbus, Ohio, and graduated high school there. Taylor had inspirations of becoming a singer. There are stories implicating that Bobby traveled to New York City and sang among future groups such as Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers and Little Anthony and the Imperials, and so on. Bobby has a working knowledge of several instruments in his forte. In 1958, Bobby Taylor began his music career as a member of the Four Pharaohs and released their first single on the Esther label entitled Gimme Your Love, back with China Girl with the Tommy Willis Orchestra in 1958. Just give me your love. Both sides were issued on Ransom and Paradise imprints. Bobby soon quit the Four Pharaohs and enrolled at San Jose State University in California and earned a degree in 1960. It was said he was also a boxer, an alternate on the U.S. team for the 1960 Summer Olympics in Rome. The same Summer Olympics that Muhammad Ali would win his first gold medal. While working as a musician, Taylor met Tommy Chong at a San Francisco club called Big Al's. Chong just started his group Little Daddy and the Bachelors and needed a drummer. So Taylor quoted, "Hey man, I can play drums." Chong said he played a couple of times, but it was his voice that was the main thing. Other drummers would fill in sets for Bobby just so they can hear him sing. As told by Tommy Chong, Bobby Taylor had a range that was unbelievable. Little Daddy and the Bachelors consisted of vocalist Tommy Melton, bassist Wes Henderson, pianist Bernie Sneed, his brother drummer Floyd Sneed, and Tommy Chong on guitar. Thomas B. Ken Chong was born on Tuesday, May 24, 1938, at the University of Alberta Hospital in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. His mother, Lorna Jean Gilchrist, was of Scott-Irish ancestry, and his father, Stanley Chong, was a Chinese truck driver who immigrated to Canada from China in the 1920s. The family moved to Gallegory, a city in the Canadian province of Alberta, when Tommy was young, settling in a conservative neighborhood where his father bought a house for $500, which Chong referred to as a dog patch. Later, Tommy enlisted in the cadets, where he stayed for 4 years. Upon his return in 1956, Tommy Chong first began playing rhythm guitar for a band led by a teenage Elvis impersonator named Dick Bird, a Native American from the Saucy tribe who lived on Stoney Indian. A few years later, Dick Bird decided to leave and form his own band. Chong met a black ex-semi-pro football star and ex-boxer named Tommy Little Daddy Milton, who was a good singer, asked to join Tommy in his group, now calling themselves the Gallegory Shades, later becoming just the Shades, a name reference to the interracial makeup. In 1960, the first portion of the Shades fell apart. Meanwhile, Tommy Chong took a truck driver's job as he and Milton reformed the Shades in 1961 and started playing regular gigs in Vancouver, where all the R&B clubs were, just barely making a living. Chong fell in love with his childhood sweetheart Maxine Sneed and got married and had two daughters, Ray Dawn and Robbie Chong. Tommy then opened up his first club, the Blues Palace, or nicknamed the Blues Balls, which he and Milton kept afloat by hiring headliner bands like the Ike and Tina Turner Review, who were booked to play for $750. By then, Tommy Chong had christened themselves as Little Daddy and the Bachelors, who were the opening act for the club. With complaints from the neighbors, Chong and Milton were pressured to look for a new location, which they found in Vancouver's Chinatown. It was a much smaller place, dubbing it T's Cabaret. It turned out to be a short-lived experience, but didn't deter them from opening up a new club called the Elegant Parlor. By this time, Floyd Sneed, the drummer, left the Bachelors to play Skins for an up-and-coming band called Redwood, who would eventually become the world-renowned group Three Dog Night. In 1964, Little Daddy and the Bachelors released a single entitled Too Much Monkey Business, the 1956 Chuck Berry classic hit on Chess Records, back with Junior's Jerk, an RCA Victor's Canada International imprint recorded in Canada. Although the club gained popularity, things soured when Tommy Chong, inspired by comedian Lenny Bruce's raunchy stand-up comedy routines, decided that the group should call themselves something new to reflect on the new social changes. Four Niggas and a Chink. When Chong displayed it on the front marquee of the Elegant Parlor, strong reactions of anger and protest was placed among the attendees. Under pressure, the group was forced to change themselves to Four Colored Guys and a Chinese Lad, and then Four N's and an A and C. Lead singer Tommy Melton, who was in Chong's band for 6 years, decided it was time for him to move on. The group then settled on the name Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers in early 1966. Now they consisted of Chong, Bobby Taylor, who took over lead vocals, Wes Henderson, along with guitarist Eddie Patterson, organist Robbie King, and drummer Ted Lewis. The latter three members having come as a package when the original Vancouvers merged with another local group called the Good Shepherds. In late 1966, Mary Wilson and Florence Ballard of the Supremes came by the Elegant Parlor one night and heard the band, whose song repertoire consisted of primarily Motown covers. Wilson and Ballard were so taken by the group, they alerted Motown CEO Berry Gordy Jr., who brought them to Detroit to play, and signed them instantly to the company's sub-label, Gordy Records. Now, Tommy Chong's story is that lead singer of the Supremes, Diana Ross, heard that the Supremes came down to Vancouver and heard about the band and phoned Berry Gordy, who flew to Canada, saw them and signed the group, and then forgot about him. Bobby Taylor, not one to be ignored, said to the guys, "Let's tour the club scene and keep busy until the company takes notice." After a few months, Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers recorded their debut single on Gordy entitled "Does Your Mama Know About Me?", a song that was first a poem written by Tommy Chong about interracial love. Chong said it was a poem on his old band member, Tommy Melton, who used to date a lot of white women, but because of his skin color, being black, he had to wait on the corner before a date because they couldn't introduce him to their parents. Chong saying that being half Chinese, there have been times, actually many times, when I had to drop a girl off at the end of the block so her parents wouldn't see who she was dating. The experience was sad to me. You know, it hurt to know that my race was a deciding factor for white people. Motown songwriter keyboardist Tom Baird read Tommy Chong's poem and put it to music. Bobby Taylor hated the song and nearly refused to do it. While chewing on his tongue, Berry Gordy disagreed with Taylor and said it was a smash. Bobby reluctantly recorded the song. Recorded in December 1967 and released on Tuesday, February 27 of 1968, "Does Your Mama Know About Me?", back with the 1966 classic Temptation B-side of "Get Ready", "Fading Away", "Does Your Mama Know About Me" charted number 5 R&B on June 1st, 1968, and number 29 pop on May 25th of the same year. One of the second groundbreaking R&B songs to reach commercial success about interracial love. The first being "Storybook Children", recorded by white singer Billy Vera and black gospel singer Judy Clay in 1967. That song charted number 20 R&B on January 13th of 1968.
Why can't we be like storybook children?
After signing to Motown, the Vancouvers had another terrifying experience of race relations when they made their first trip to Detroit during the summer of 1967, as the riots were raging the city. Bobby Taylor recalls, "The guys were scared. They were scared to death. And they didn't stay in Detroit one night. Motown had to take them across the border into Canada, and that's where they stayed." The Gordy label issued the Vancouver's second single, "I Am Your Man", composed by Nick Ashford and Valerie Simpson, and produced by Frank Wilson, back with "The Swingin' If You Love Her", penned by Tom Baird and Bobby Taylor, hitting number 40 R&B on September 28th, 1968 for 6 weeks.
Now my life can begin, for I am your man. If you love her, if you love her,
the Vancouvers began touring various theaters around the country promoting their singles. On one Friday afternoon, July 12, 1968, a historical extravaganza called the Battle of the Groups took place at the Regal Theater in Chicago for 10 days. The other contestants in the show include Taylor and the Vancouvers, the Artistics, the Vibrations, the Esquires, Dyke and the Blazers, Marshall and the Shylights, and an opening act that would go on to make music history, the Jackson 5.
Well, come on,
Bobby Taylor's association with the Jackson 5 began through a connection with Weldon McDougal, a regional promotion man for Motown Records. McDougal was making preparations for a Bobby Taylor and the Vancouver show in a club in Chicago. Now, this particular club had a talent show on Wednesday evenings. McDougal was there and caught the Jackson 5's act and was kind of oblivious because he compared them to another get-over act that he saw called the Twilights. The Jackson 5's father and manager, Joe Jackson, found out that Weldon was associated with Motown. Jackson reached out to McDougal and said they would like to be on Motown. Joe and another associate made a deal with Atlantic Records through an indie label, Steeltown, founded in Gary, Indiana, their hometown. Jackson felt that Motown was a bigger company. McDougal said that he was just a promotion man, but Bobby Taylor just got an agreement with Motown to produce anyone at free hand. Weldon then introduced the Jackson 5 clan to Bobby Taylor. The Jackson 5 traveled with Bobby and the Vancouvers as the opening act at the world-famous Apollo Theater in Harlem, New York, the Uptown in Philadelphia, and then the Regal in Chicago. The group wowed the audience in every performance. Bobby Taylor even quoted about lead singer Michael Jackson's moves, saying, "Damn, that little sucker dances like James Brown." The Jackson clan took up residence in Bobby Taylor's apartment complex. Neighbors would complain about the noises made by the boys while rehearsing. Taylor even purchased a lion as a pet. Bobby then contacted Susan DePass, who just became Berry Gordy's creative consultant at Motown in just 14 days. DePass, who lived in the same building complex as Bobby, was reluctant, but came to his apartment and found the boys stretched out in Taylor's living room. Taylor then instructed the boys with a hand clap to sing a cappella. Susan was floored. Soon afterwards, Bobby and J5 were thrown out of the complex. The Jackson 5 was scheduled to go to New York to do their very first television appearance on the David Frost Show, but was canceled because Motown had called and scheduled them for an audition. Bobby Taylor initiated that audition by contacting Ralph Seltzer, the head of Motown's creative department and legal team. At first, Seltzer had reservations, but eventually gave the green light for the group to audition. The audition date was Tuesday, July 23rd, 1968, and was filmed, rumored, by Bobby Taylor's camera equipment. It would take some coaxing and nudging by Susan DePass to finally try to convince Berry Gordy to sign the group. After Berry saw the audition tape, he was very impressed. Gordy quoted, "These kids are talented, but when I saw the lead singer Michael, he reminded me of a young Frankie Lyman." The Jackson 5 passed the audition and signed with Motown on Friday, July 26, 1968. You know, credit should also be given to Gladys Knight and the Pips, who saw the J5 first at the Regal in 1967, where her and the Pips were making an appearance for a week's stay. Impressed with the young starlets, Knight, who joined the Motown roster in 1966 and didn't have much weight in the company, said that she tried to call the label and had them send down a representative to see the kids perform in the Wednesday night show. One of the representatives from Motown was Taylor Cox. Cox promised that he would get there to see them, but he didn't. Well, listen, Gladys Knight should be duly knighted for her efforts in the genesis of the J5's career. Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers continued to tour and make television appearances. The Gordy imprint issued their third masterpiece single entitled Melinda, composed by Smokey Robinson, Al Cleveland, and Terry Johnson, former tenor singer and guitar player of the legendary Flamingos, who Smokey recruited onto the Motown roster as an artist, but in truth, the company wanted Johnson for a writer and producer. Back with the Temptations' 1965 classic remake of It's Growing, Melinda hit number 20 R&B on January 4th of 1969. In August 1968, a self-titled album, Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers, charted number 20 on Billboard Soul LP on October 19, 1968. I Am Your Man and Melinda were originally intended to be solo Bobby Taylor songs, but was credited to the group. After the band issued three hit singles and the self-titled album, Bobby Taylor moved on to work with the Jackson 5, while the Vancouvers ended up performing in support of Motown artist Chris Clark. Members Tommy Chong and Wes Henderson were fired for arriving late at a Friday night gig after they wanted to apply for green cards, which would enable them to work and live in the U.S. Berry Gordy told Tommy Chong that he wasn't fired, but Chong told him that he wanted to stay fired because he wanted Berry's position in the company to be his own boss. Berry understood and gave Tommy $5,000 as servant's pay. Maybe I shouldn't worry. The Vancouvers broke up afterwards, when Tommy Chong attempted to have the group's contract halved so that he and Taylor and Henderson would become frontmen, while the remaining members, Robbie King, Eddie Patterson, and Ted Lewis, would be regarded as sidemen and session artists. After the breakup, Bobby Taylor soon auditioned for the lead singer position in The Temptations, following David Ruffin's exit from the group, but was turned down because he was too short and he had flat feet. Tommy Chong returned to Vancouver, Canada with a new venture in mind: improvisational theater. Chong moved his old club, the Elegant Parlor, to the Shanghai Junk Club in the Chinatown section, which was a very rough place. It was owned by Tommy's brother, Stan. It originally was a strip joint turned into a comedy troupe with girls who were former strippers, named City Works. One day, a Mexican guy delivering carpets next door came into the club. He was fast and funny and tired of laying carpets, so Tommy offered him $5 a week, more than he was getting laying rugs, to do comedy. His name was Cheech Martin, and now he was making $60 a week as a member of City Works. Within the next few years, Cheech Martin and Tommy Chong teamed up as a comedy duo and would rise to stardom with their classic stand-up, studio recordings, and feature films based on the hippie, free love, drugs, and counterculture movements of the 1970s and the 1980s. Cheech and Chong won their first and only Grammy for their 1973 album, Los Cochinos, on Old Records for Best Comedy Recording in 1974. Due to creative differences, Cheech and Chong parted ways in the 1980s, but would team up again for voice animated characters and Cheech Martin's CBS TV show, Nash Bridges, and various reunion shows over the years. After the Jackson 5 signed to Motown, Bobby Taylor became the group's first producer. He flew to Los Angeles to supervise their first album, Diana Ross Presents the Jackson 5. Taylor cut mostly old soul tunes, including one classic Miracles remake of Who's Loving You, becoming the B-side of their first million seller, I Want You Back, and their most cherished B-side song. Bobby wanted to demonstrate their vocal skills, but Berry Gordy wanted a contemporary sound that would cross over all segments of music. So he gathered around a group of West Coast songwriters, Deke Richards, Fonz Menzel, Freddie Perrin, Willie Hutch, including Berry himself, and Bobby, and named them The Corporation. After the J5 album hit number one R&B and number five pop in 1970, Bobby Taylor co-produced a few of the group's hits, including I Want You Back, ABC, I'll Be There, Going Back to Indiana, but never received any credit. According to the Motown staff, Bobby Taylor was hard to get along with, so they ousted him out by 1970. Tommy Chong said in the 2016 interview that Motown had a Bobby Taylor alert. The secretaries would pick up the phone and said, Bobby Taylor's in the building. Not wanting to associate with him, they would lock the doors. The J5 situation caused the IRS problems for Taylor, so he sued the company, Motown, for back royalties. He won the suit, but claims he never got paid. Bobby Taylor became a solo artist and released his first album on Gordy in late 1969 entitled Taylor Made Soul. One single, Oh I've Been Blessed, back with Blackmail, was issued on Motown's sub-label VIP. Oh, I've been blessed. Someone I haven't seen. Someone I can't forget. And My Girl Is Gone, a Miracles 1965 classic cover, back with It Should Have Been Me Loving Her on Gordy, both released in 1969, but failed to chart because of lack of promotion from the company. After two single releases on Motown's West Coast sub-label Mo-West, Hey Lordy, back with Just a Little Bit Closer in 1971, Bobby Taylor left Motown Records soon after. Bobby Taylor recorded sporadically on various labels, such as Sunflower, Tommy, Philadelphia International Records, and his last charted R&B hit single on the Playboy label entitled Why Play Games, back with Don't Wonder Why, that hit number 83 R&B on September 6, 1975. Throughout the years, Bobby Taylor formed an offshoot group called the New Vancouvers and recorded an album for Ian Levine's Motor City Records in 1990 called Find My Way Back and The Best of the Motor City Volume 20 in 1997 featuring the song Cloudy Day. Taylor rekindled a romance from the 1960s with Linda Smith and got married, which only lasted a decade. When he was diagnosed with throat cancer, Taylor lived with his mother before returning to the West Coast and making his home in San Jose. Later, he was also diagnosed what leukemia.
I've seen the sun.
Bobby Taylor traveled to North Vancouver, Canada, and founded a club called the R&B Connection, mentoring inspiring singers, and he also taught choir. In 2006, Taylor moved to Beijing, China, and opened up a recording studio and a music school, while again battling throat cancer. He then relocated to Hong Kong, performing a Motown theme show under the name The Bobby Taylor Band, where he also shot a rare video of such. Taylor also made frequent appearances at clubs, jazz festivals, and so forth while teaching school. On Saturday, February 18, 2017, Bobby Taylor made his final public performance in Hong Kong on his 83rd birthday. Sadly, on Saturday, July 22nd, Bobby Taylor died of cancer in a Hong Kong hospital. Before his passing, while lying in his hospital bed, Bobby kept quoting to his manager, "I want to work. I want to work." His last known recording was the unreleased Humanity, a tribute to the late rock guitarist Dick Wagner. Bobby Taylor's legacy with the Jackson 5 was not overlooked. He once said that he'd never received any credit and appreciation for his contribution to their major success. Even Berry Gordy chimed in and once said to Taylor, "By the time they become famous, they'll forget all about you." Well, not so. Jackson brothers Marlon Jermaine has credited Bobby Taylor over the years for their breakthrough success. After Bobby's death, Jermaine Jackson offered a two-page tribute on Twitter staccato. He said, "Our mentor, Bobby Taylor, put the J5 on the path and worked with us on many songs on our first album. Taught me so much about singing with feeling." Vancouver's member and keyboardist Robbie King recorded on numerous of Motown recordings from 1967 to 1970, and also arranged and played on the worldwide 1974 masterpiece hit Seasons in the Sun by Terry Jacks.
We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun, but the hills that we climbed were just seasons out of time.
And has played with Alice Cooper and Errol Smith. Sadly, Robbie King died on Friday, October 17, 2003, at the age of 57. Drummer Ted Lewis had moved to British Columbia Durris and joined the George Leach Band and has recorded one CD, released during the summer of 2009. Lewis had taught workshops in private institutions with a focus on First Nation students as well as troubled youths. Other member Wes Henderson recorded a two-sided single on Motown's Rare Earth label with In Bed and Reality in 1971. Tommy Chong made his visual mark in the millennium by appearing on the hit Fox Network TV show The Masked Singer, disguised as a pineapple. He was unmasked on the January 9th Wednesday night episode.
My goodness, wow! You gotta tell us, what would make you do something like put a pineapple on your head and sing I Will Survive?
Anything to get on stage.
Yeah!
You know, together or individually, Bobby Taylor and the Vancouvers were gifted, talented musicians whose artistry in the music business will solely be celebrated by fans all over the globe. For they will go down in history as one of the greatest Canadian bands during the Motown era of the 1960s. Let's just be thankful that the music outlives the band. Until we meet again musically, I am the Chancellor Soul. Soul Facts, a show written, created, produced, and copywritten by the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone, and is a nonprofit music presentation.